In the center, Army Group A, spearheaded by its panzer groups, bypassed the fortifications of the Maginot Line, smashed through thin French defenses, and raced into the interior. The tanks then swung north to reach the Channel coast. By May the 27th, most of the Allies' best divisions and almost all their mobile formations were trapped in a huge cauldron. By June the 5th, the pocket had been all but eliminated, and the British had been evacuated from Dunkirk. The main German effort now switched to the south. And 4 days later, Army Group B reached the Seine below Paris. Army Group A broke through on May the 12th, and with Army Group C, encircled French forces behind the Maginot Line. With the French retreating all along the front, on June the 17th, the government sued for peace. In less than 6 weeks, Germany had conquered 4 countries and 250,000 square miles of territory. On June the 22nd, the French signed the armistice that confirmed Adolf Hitler as master of Western Europe. The campaign had succeeded beyond his wildest dreams. But even as his generals looked forward to their field marshal's batons, their estates, and the wealth of plunder that would be theirs, Hitler's own thoughts were elsewhere. He had won his empire, but he also faced a fundamental strategic problem. To sustain the German military machine, the Reich needed oil, raw materials, and foodstuffs, and neither Germany nor the newly conquered territories could provide them. Hitler worried that Germany was already dependent on huge imports from the Soviet Union, and there was no telling how long these would be forthcoming. Even more troubling, Russia had once again taken advantage of German commitments in the West. To the Soviet conquest of eastern Poland in September 1939, and the seizure of Finnish territory that winter, Stalin now added the Baltic states of Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia. In June 1940, they were declared part of the Soviet Union, threatening German trade in the Baltic. Hitler's reply was an agreement with the Finns that would allow German troops on Finnish soil. The next stirrings of Soviet ambition were felt in the south. Romania was ordered to hand over Bessarabia and northern Bukovina. And on June the 27th, these territories were occupied by the Red Army. Romania was Germany's main source of oil, and the Soviets now had strong forces massed within striking distance. Hitler's response was to deploy powerful formations in Poland, and later he would win a string of agreements, allowing him to send German troops to Romania, Hungary, and Bulgaria. While Germany and the Soviet Union jockeyed for advantage in the Balkans and the Baltic, in the West, there remained a thorn in Germany's side. Britain was still defiant. Her army had been driven from France, leaving nearly all its heavy weapons behind. But Winston Churchill, the new Prime Minister, was refusing to negotiate. Not only did he proclaim that Britain would fight to the end, but he also launched a diplomatic initiative to turn Russia against Germany. In fact, Stalin had no intention of being drawn into a war which could only benefit the capitalist West. The British overture was firmly rebuffed. By the time Adolf Hitler had returned to Berlin after his triumphant campaign in France, he had already made up his mind to attack and conquer the Soviet Union. From the beginning, Hitler had built the Nazi Party on a deep hatred of communists, Jews, and Slavs, and he was convinced that Soviet communism was a Jewish conspiracy. Now he had a unique opportunity to destroy his ideological and racial enemies. At the same time, he could win for Germany the resources that would secure the Reich for generations to come. Hitler was haunted by two great fears. The first was that the Soviet Union, already embarked on a massive armaments program, would soon be so well prepared for war that the chance of a successful German attack would vanish forever. The second was the prospect of an alliance between Russia, Britain, and the United States. An alliance which Germany's slender resources could never defeat. Hitler concluded that the Reich's only hope of survival lay in the complete destruction of the Soviet Union. However, it would have to be done within a year, at the very most. On July the 31st, 1940, Hitler announced to his senior military commanders that he intended to attack Russia not later than the summer of 1941. The generals protested that with Britain still hostile, Germany was exposing itself to the danger of a war on two fronts. Hitler dismissed their fears. He had seen the Red Army's dismal performance in Finland, and now he predicted, "You have only to kick in the door, and the whole rotten structure will come crashing down." Since 1928, Joseph Stalin had kept his position of supreme power in the Soviet Union by the most devious and ruthless means. Everyone who might conceivably threaten his authority was killed. In 1937, he had turned his attention to the Soviet armed forces. In a relentless sweep, Stalin executed all 11 deputy commissars for defense, 3 out of 5 field marshals, 13 out of 15 army commanders, and tens of thousands of middle-ranking and junior officers. Many more were sent to labor camps. Stalin replaced the executed senior commanders with cronies from his Civil War days, however incompetent. And within a year, the Red Army was firmly under the dictator's personal control. In 1940, the army's humiliation at the hands of the Finns had persuaded Stalin that the Soviet armed forces had to be reformed. The incredible speed of Germany's victory over France only underlined the urgency of the task. However, with so many of Russia's most effective commanders gone, progress was slow and hesitant. Although Stalin was deeply worried about German intentions, he was sure that while Britain was still fighting, Hitler would never attack.